Yay! A battle. Or our friends. Our new friends. That was some fight! Beltrax's bearded face is full of concern. Are you hurt? He carries a variety of well-worn weapons on his person, and a bandolier of small images and trinkets across his body. He claps a hand to his chest. I'm Beltrax. His companion is a slight, nervous man in a hooded robe of blue and white. He bows. I'm sorry you had to face those cultists. We hid and, well... He bows, a small tremble in his hands as he does so. I have a favor to request. Those cultists, the children of the Endless Gate, they have overrun the Valley of Dead Heroes. They slaughter the visitors. They hound us, the memorialists, and have brought horror to every corner of this ancient place. Please, you have shown your mettle in dealing with these murderers. I beg of you, please find a way to make them move on. I'll do it.
I'll remember that.
He sags with relief. Thank you, friend. The coming of the children has been a relentless nightmare for us. I wish you the best of luck. More gold tied for me. Tell me about the memorialists. We're ordinary people, really. People understand the truth that this world is really the afterlife, and that the tombs here are our graves. We maintain the valley so that no name is forgotten, so that everyone can come here and remember their true selves. Once all the tombs have been claimed, we shall see a glorious resurgence of humanity. Likewise, if we allow the names to be forgotten, devastation will sweep across the land. We are simple caretakers of life, that is all. We want to safeguard the message of the Valley's truth, and to ensure that all names will never be forgotten. Tell me about yourself. My true name is Ronus Kasul, of the Memorialists. I came here from Sega's Cliffs to inter my beloved wife. That was over a decade ago. I remained because I felt a close connection to the place. Somehow. When I discovered the name of my true self, I knew. This world is the afterlife, and the graves here are our own. Now I study the world of the living, hoping to bring others to the enlightenment I reached. I once believed in this life as most do, until I saw the tomb of the hero I was in my true life. Now I help guide others through the valley. Tell me about the Valley of Dead Heroes. It has been a burial ground for the world for at least millions of years. Yet, and he holds up a finger like a lecturer, yet we have uncovered no bodies in the valley itself. Oh no. Despite all the memorials, obelisks, and urns above the ground, we have not been able to find evidence of a single body. Markers exist beyond counting. Some are in scripts we cannot understand. Some are in materials we have never seen. But the bodies themselves lie in a great space beneath the ground. Above the ground there is no sign of life. None at all, except what we bring with us. It's a mausoleum of many prior worlds, a place of stunning sadness, unimaginable pride, and great wonder, a true representation of the secrets of the Ninth World. I'm looking for the tomb of the first cast-off. I do not know that tomb. You might be able to find it yourself at the entrance of the great necropolis. You can enter it up there. He points off in the distance and up. The entrance must be in the cliff face somewhere. You must be strong or careful, though, or both. The children are vicious and unpredictable. Oh, I don't get to ask that again. Okay. Farewell. Have you taken care of the cultists? The longer it takes, the more I fear for all of us. He puts his hand across his eyes. I'm sorry. I shouldn't rush you. How can I help you? Now let's talk to Beltrax. Hello again, my friend. Tell me about yourself. This sounds embarrassing when I say it out loud, but I came here to meet up with a sorcerer to quest for a fabled magic board. He shrugs. I haven't met the sorcerer yet, but I did meet a memorialist. She told me about the work they do here, about this being the afterlife, that the names we bore in life are hidden in the valley in the names of the dead, who she called the truly living. I have to admit, though, That was about the most cark tripe I'd ever heard. But she said something after. Shadows fall where they will, as they will. Meaning, if we're shadows of other lives, then, like shadows, we can't control what we are. That stuck with me. What if she's right? He plucks one of the lockets from his bandolier, pops it open, and reveals a glowing image of a woman. He regards her wistfully. What if she's still alive somewhere? What if this isn't life? If I'm just a shadow waiting to step into the light? What if she's there waiting for me? Drink. It's preposterous, I know. You look at it from the outside and it's... But think about it. This world is flat and cold and... empty. He looks at the woman's image again. It feels right to believe there's another life. One that feels like living. He closes the locket. So I've been learning more. Vronos was my guide through the valley when those carkers came upon us. We crawled into a sepulcher behind those boards and... Well, you know the rest. He laughs softly. I'm just your ordinary explorer, one who might just be turning into a carking memorialist one day myself. So he's not a memorialist, at least not yet. What can you tell me about the valley? It's a vast graveyard of sorts, but you're not going to find any bodies here above ground. You'll need to get to the necropolis to find the real tombs. But to get there, you've got to use the minims. Floating pools of light. And when you walk into one, you walk out its twin somewhere else. Like the floating pool of light way back in the beginning in the Dark Fathom? The minims always appear in pairs. My theory is that they're alive. Some sort of creatures. Anyway, each pair remains in the same locations for years at a time, I'm told, but sometimes they move or reappear somewhere else entirely. Far as I can tell, using them is perfectly safe. He thinks, I haven't heard of anyone dying from the minims, though I guess I wouldn't now, would I? Can you tell me any more about the minims? Not really, just walk in one, walk out the other. They're the best way to get around the valley. The only way in most cases. How long have the cultists been here? They came to the valley recently. Perhaps a month, perhaps only a week or two. Maybe some of them have been here for longer than that. I don't know. The children's arrival was slow and insidious. They didn't make the ruckus they're making now. Then a few days ago they just went berserk. Started abducting and slaughtering and, well, here we are. Maybe a month or more, but their activity wasn't anything like it is now. Safe travels to you, friend. Or safer ones, at least. Alright, let's get loot. Is this loot? This
all
is
right.
Loot. 10 shins. Oh, and a buzzer. Cool. I still need to sell things. I'm assuming I have the buzzer? Yeah. Because we need to sell that. You already have one or two of them.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Get that. Get it. What? Get this then. Another buzzer. Ooh, a shadow flower. And a dagger. A well-used, carefully honed dagger. One of the simplest weapons available, but in the right hands, also one of the most lethally quick. What's this thing? Shadow flower. This flower has an everlasting, pulsating, light blue glow that becomes stronger with few lights around. Curiously, the pulsation period is approximately equal to the heart rate of a relaxed human. On occasion, and for no apparent reason, the pulse quickens, as if in fear or anger. In absolute darkness, it blooms with a light beyond the visual spectrum. We're not in absolute darkness. You see anything else? Can we use this thing? Nope. One of those oddities that's just so odd, we have no idea what to do with it. That's an examine. Okay. Let me just save real quick before something else happens. I think we're on 54. Well, technically 55, but...
I'm going.
Ooh. Look at all this crap.
Absolutely.
Abso-fraggin-lutely. A foul-smelling liquid pours out of these spouts to the rest of the valley far below. Its mist feels cool in the bright sun. A faint humming emanates from these two statues. Is that one of those teleporting things? Oh, look at that.
Coming.
Oh!
Coming, dear. What?
The Valley of Dead Heroes. I like it here. There's absolutely no place we should avoid completely.
He thinks, is that subtle enough? We will have to see. We are full of suspense. Are you trying to hide something from me? No, Eridus says with a fixed grin. Sweat gleams on his brow. I just like it here. Who wouldn't? I don't. He swallows hard. I don't. He thinks, we didn't tell him to say that. His mind is pushing against ours.
Updated my journal.
Every inch of this valley is packed with adventure. One of his hands comes up, trembling to cover his eyes. Interesting people. Places to explore, like... He trails off, biting his lip. We should explore all of it, even the alcoves. I'm not afraid of any of it. Stop shouting at me. And he thinks, but we don't want him to go back to the alcove. We are using clever manipulation. Are you trying... Why are you trying to manipulate me, Eridus? He rocks backwards on his feet, almost as if your words have struck him a blow. His eyes fill with desperate tears. I'm not. Please. I'm not. Help me. And he thinks, what is happening? Let us direct him. No! His glow returns, and he sinks into it gratefully, smiling. I don't even know what that word means, he mumbles. I'm fine. Everything is fine. Forget I said anything. But his gaze has slipped from yours to fix on the empty air. What do you know about the Valley of Dead Heroes? Well, it's full of dead heroes, he says, concentrating. I think that's somewhere in the name. He stares around. On second thought, I didn't die here, so maybe the name is wrong. I just... Grimacing, he holds his head. I remember someone sleeping here in an alcove. He sighs, smiling in relief. And then I woke up, and I never saw the alcove again. The end. He thinks, the hero is talking about our prison again. Whose idea was it to remind him? Yours. Why didn't you stop us? Heroes are here, he says helpfully. Dead ones. Where is this alcove you mentioned? The easy smile falls from Eritus's face. He looks away. I wasn't talking about any alcove, just alcoves in general. In the Valley of Dead Heroes, I'm not frightened of them. Blinking rapidly, he gives you a fierce look. I'm not. I'm still looking for that alcove of yours. It's not mine, he shouts. And actually, I don't know what you're talking about. Some questions about you. I'm not surprised, he says, pleased. I'm incredibly interesting. What do you want to know? I don't think I've ever seen you sleep. I close my eyes sometimes, he says, blinking. He gasps and points at the offending lids urgently. Did you see that again? I did it again. That does it. He forces both eyes wide with the pads of his thumbs. Now I'll never miss a chance for adventure. See what he does next. It's working. Eritus gasps, tears streaming from his eyes. I'd congratulate myself, but it's probably better if you do it. No one likes to hear a handsome man giving himself compliments. You need your rest, Eritus. I rest, he protests, thumbs slipping from his eyes in shock. I'm resting right now. I'm not fighting or leaping or singing or anything. Can't you tell me anything about the voices I keep hearing in your head? If you're hearing voices, that sounds like you're a problem, not mine. How are things between us? Great! I knew we had the same instincts for adventure. Alright. Let's see if anyone else has anything to say about this place.
Huh. You do forget how empty the world is outside of a city's soft and welcoming arms.
He sighs, surveying the valley with a disappointed air. City boy, are you? Not quite, he says with a dismissive wave. I've had some of the best times in my life in dirty holes beneath tree trunks, but there's something magical about a soft bed, wherever it belongs to. He adjusts his belt. Anyway, did you need something? Do you know anything about the Valley of Dead Heroes? Not much, he says, looking around. Never been here myself, but I hear it used to be a nice place. Now, I've heard stories. Not the good kind, no. The ones that finish with, their toenails were found in a bloody heap. He raises his palms. And no, don't ask to hear them. I've just spoiled all their endings. Let's just choose safe places to rest, shall we? If there are any. There's not much to tell. Ash and death everywhere you look. Cultists and carkers beyond that. Nothing else new. Calistiche? Her eyes are flat and measuring. Well, I can't ask her about the Valley of Dead Heroes. I think I've read this, so I'm just going to leave it. If you guys want to read it, you can pause the video. Okay. I got some more time left, so... Oh, light minim. Dark minim. Oh, these are the minims. Minim.
Of course.
Not of course. What's this? That is not identified, although I can see it on the map.
Action! Here well, I come!
Naturally, have to check it out. A patch of darkness hangs before you, like a black spot on your retina, except it doesn't move when you move your eyes. Looking into it is like looking into an abandoned cave. No breeze or sound or shadows stir within it, and its edges are slowly disintegrating. Try to determine the nature of the darkness. As soon as you get close to it, you feel an anguished mind responding to your presence. Whatever the darkness is, it's alive, if only barely, and seeking something. There is a desperation to the contact that is palpable. A lance of darkness stretches toward you tentatively, questioningly. It wants a bond. I have no idea. I don't think I should be bonding with darkness. Is that any worse than stepping into darkness? Let's step into the darkness, because I just have to see what happens. The darkness surrounds you. You are whipped by it as if by a wind. It is a swirling vortex with no way ahead and no way back. The opening you pass through has vanished into utter blackness. A hail of tiny objects batters you in the dark, thrown by the wind. Rocks or bones or drit, you cannot tell. Then something large and sharp slams into you, and you wrestle with it for a moment before realizing it's a skeleton, though not human. Ooh. I gain a stim. As you try to shrug it off, you feel an object in its hand. You pry it free, and the skeleton falls past you. Then the wind lofts you toward a bright spot in the darkness, and you tumble back out of the opening you entered, clutching the stolen object in your hand. You've gained a stim. This odd syringe contains a liquid that moves on its own, regardless of how it's held. The needle is pristine and adorned with strange symbols. When injected, the liquid inside grants a momentary and pure clarity, giving a significant boost to a single great challenge facing the user. Consumes movement as four uses, supposedly. It doesn't disappear like the other thing does. Plus 45% on non-combat tasks. You enter the dark whirlwind again, and again you are battered by debris before being spit back out the same opening you came in. If this is a portal to somewhere, it seems to be blocked. Before I start bond with darkness? Calistige. She can use that. Actually, I should probably have that. Yeah, the fresh vapors. It says five uses. And unfortunately we can't see how many uses, but I don't think I ever used it. But I used it once and it disappeared, so I restored that save for that, and I think another reason as well. So I'm gonna keep this, because I'm the one... who's going to be using effort to do things. Root spike, I will give to her. Here we go. Okay. Alright. Pure curiosity, which is like 90% of why I do anything in this game, is to see what happens. Bond with the darkness. You reach out to touch the lance of darkness. It steps forward suddenly through your hand and into your chest. There's a flash of pain, and you can feel its desperation, its need to be connected. Then the lance recedes, but something remains lodged in your chest, pulsing alongside your heart. You also feel more sharp and alert. It has given you a piece of itself. Cool, we permanently gain one intellect. Maxim is now 17. Worth it. And I didn't get any... It didn't fulfill any, you know... What do you call it? Gold, blue. It's blocked. Well, I'm glad I could help, whatever the hell happened.
Slayer.
Now, can I walk past this stuff?
Action! Here I come!
Oh, that's the light minim is this. So whatever this is, I can't interact with it. There's another dark one over there. Persea! I should not be able to see all the way over here. Cool stuff coming up though, guys.
At last.
Ooh, look at that symbol. This is the same symbol that we found at all the murder sites. I remember... I kind of memorized it. down in the underbelly. Scrawled as a portal. So whoever created this portal... maybe came out here. Before I go through any of these portals... Oh, I can't go that way? Oh.
Fine.
There's a wall there. The glowing liquid seeps out from cracks deep within this central hill. These are all over. The symbol is painted everywhere, so much so that the air is thick with the coppery scent of blood, both dry and fresh. So I can't look at this little ball thing.
All right.
Colo? And Natalie. Body over there. We'll get it when we come back. Colo, you're seeing things that aren't there again. Of course it's there, Natalie. It's just not... here. We've been over this. Here is the only place that counts. Huh. The other you said the same thing 5 minutes ago. Alright, I guess we'll talk to these guys. Hail, Natalie. Alright. Hack it off right there. Colo. Okay. I'm observing him. He's not saying this. Distracted? Disturbed? This cultist mutters a reply to a question you did not hear. He barks a laugh to a quip that was not told. Indeed, he seems only loosely aware of anyone else's presence. He brings a cleaver down just inches from the other's hand. And he thinks, perfect, beautiful, free in every world. Will you watch what you're doing? You nearly severed my arm instead of his. The air around Colo becomes hazy as he smiles. Sorry? Didn't catch that. Too much going on. The two cultists break off their conversation as they notice you. The man... Okay, so he wasn't talking to us when he said that. Although he turned to face us when he said, hack it off right there. I thought he was telling us to stop right there. So he was actually literally telling the guy to hack off the guy's hand. The two cultists break off their conversation as they notice you. The man, big, raw-boned, and unsettlingly unfocused, backs away from the corpse they've been hacking up and raises his butcher knife as if he's warding off evil. He points past you toward Calistige. Keep that crazy redhead away from me. We don't want anything to do with her. He thinks, oh skist, I was hoping this reality would be one I survived. That's right, Husk, says Calistige, laughing. I am your doom here, there, in every reality you can see. Don't you forget it. You and Calistius have met before? What does she do to you? Colo sneers. Fought you all 3 times so far, walking through here, and twice that redhead did for me. But I still put my knife in your neck in every stream, so think twice before starting something. What do you mean in every... I don't know what he's talking about. What do you mean in every reality? Don't pretend you don't know what I'm talking about. She's like me. She can see into different realities. Calistige shakes her head in contempt. I'm like you, little man? Please. Someday you might crawl from the mud and look up at the stars. And when you do, you'll see me laughing down. We'll leave you alone if you leave us alone. Fine. Just go. And take her with you. Calistige chuckles as the two cultists warily turn back to the body and continue to hack it into portable chunks. Crazy husk. Get away from us.
All right.
I can't investigate this body. What? I thought I could. What about this Natalie guy? Just stay out of our way. All right. Whoever that is, they're already dead, so...
At last!
Oh my.
Gladly.
The hell? Huh.
Yes.
This 5-meter-long black slab of basalt, or perhaps obsidian, has been smoothed by age. A stone statue holds the slab at an angle, lifting it to the sky, or he is lowering it. It is impossible to determine whether the incline is real or if you imagined it. At the top end you can see a window into another reality, a portal wide enough to step through. On the other side is what looks like a harsh and angular world. Examine the statue. It is a gray statue of a robed man with an ornate warhammer strapped to his back, holding the obelisk aloft, or setting it down gently with his muscular arms. He exudes a fierce determination, as if he were using every quantum of energy in raising or lowering the great slab. A sign has been added to his back, a childish scrawl that reads, "The Saint of Proverbs." You can hear something, the faint whisper of human thought. You can't make out what it's saying, but it feels like it's coming from the statue itself. Huh. Examine the slab. It seems perfectly smooth. Some loving hand has polished it to a mirror gloss, though distortions beneath its surface change your appearance with every slight movement. As you lean in to examine it, your reflection appears unspeakably beautiful. A few centimeters closer, and it becomes a shrieking horror. This close, you can feel a dense psychic weight around the obelisk, as if the creature's hopes, as if a culture's hopes and expectations had been packed into a single solid form. The thought of meeting those expectations and ascending the incline is daunting. Nothing has changed. It remains black and smooth, distorting your reflection with your every slight movement. Speak to the statue. Are you raising the slab or lowering it? The statue does not answer you. Perhaps it cannot answer you. Okay. Before we go into this portal thing, climbing up the slab, I'm going to call in an episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you. Ooh, who's that? Phoenix. Cool. Anyone with the name Phoenix has to be cool. Stuff. Silk ribbons and banners flap softly against stone. These decorations are recent, perhaps several years old, but like everything else here, they've been forgotten. Alright, before I do anything else, I don't want to stop playing, but I really have to go to bed. So thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.